In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Last week we heard about Jesus' appearing to his disciples on the Sea of Tiberias. It was the third appearance that he made to them in the 40 days between his resurrection and his ascension. We heard that our Lord stood upon the shore calling to his disciples, and yet they did not immediately recognize him, for he had changed in some way. The body standing before them, beckoning them from the shore, was the same body which had walked with them on the hills of Galilee. It was the same body that had eaten with tax collectors and sinners, the same body which had healed the blind and fed the 5,000, the same body that suffered under Pilate's scourge and was crucified and buried. Yet, it was also the body that had descended into hell and been raised on the third day. It had conquered death, and now it was glorified. And he is the first fruits of the dead, the man from heaven in whose image we will all be recreated. He is the end, the perfection, the goal of our own resurrected bodies. He represents the destiny of what we are destined to be. We are destined to die and be buried and yet rise again with an abundance of life. This is why the church rightly calls the cemetery God's garden. The seeds have been planted and a bumper crop is assured by our Heavenly Father. Now, last week's gospel gave us a picture of our future hope in the resurrection. Today's gospel gives us a lesson in what we might call the intermediary state. Sorry, today's epistle lesson is what we'll be focusing on. We'll be focusing on Revelation chapter 7, which also comes from John. It shows us the state of the saints who have fallen asleep in Christ, whose bodies wait safely in the grave for the resurrection to come. It shows us the paradise of the soul while awaiting resurrection. By the time that John receives his revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ, recorded for us here in the book of Revelation, the apostle has suffered for his witness to the gospel. Yet he stands as the last remaining apostle. According to church tradition, he finds himself exiled on the island of Patmos on account of God's word by the personal orders of the Emperor Domitian. In the midst of his suffering, John continues to testify to the other island inhabitants about Jesus. And through his faithful witness, the Holy Spirit continues to draw those on the island into the church. John, like the other apostles, would not be silent. No man, emperor or not, would make John hold his peace about the one who had brought peace between God and man. And even there on Patmos, the church gathered. Every other apostle has been martyred. The first being John's own brother, James, executed in 44 AD by Herod. But the rest would soon follow. Peter was crucified just as Jesus had prophesied on the shore of Tiberias. Paul, who was the latecomer to the apostolic band, was beheaded in the same year. Thomas, who had doubted, was run through by a spear. They and all the apostles, besides John, spilled their blood to testify to the one whose spilt blood redeemed the world. I'm sure these testimonies of his beloved friends were never far from John's mind. John records that on the Lord's Day, that is Sunday, he receives an apocalypse of Jesus Christ. That is, he receives a vision. When we hear the word apocalypse, we immediately think about the end of the world. But in Greek, it simply means a revelation. It is a curtain that is being pulled back to reveal that which is hidden from our limited sense perception. And that is what John sees in his vision today. He sees the communion of saints who are in Christ, with whom we are joined in the Holy Communion. In the middle of the divine service, as the saints of Patmos are gathered together, the curtain is ripped from before John's eyes, and behold, he sees a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands. He sees the church triumphant, no longer separated by geography, divided by language, or distressed by heresy. He sees the saints gathered in festal worship before God and before the Lamb. These glorious saints from every tribe and people and nation are united in praise and worship. Yet, they are still individuals. They are still full of recognizable diversity. In death, when the law of God finally puts to death our sinful nature, once and for all, we are not absorbed into the divinity, as the Hindus and many Orthodox Jews believe. Our individuality does not melt away as we're dissolved into the one. No, we remain ourselves. Distinct and unique creations of God, yet we are more fully ourselves. Perfectly ourselves in communion with our Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. Before the throne of God, the saints stand together in true unity and true diversity, in a way that cannot be glimpsed here on earth except here in God's Christian church. John sees and hears the throng crying out with a loud voice. And they aren't just shouting with voices raised, but they are shouting and singing in hymnody. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. They glorify God and glorify the Lamb, who are alone responsible for salvation. There is no greater worship than this, than to turn to God as the giver of every good gift. As the giver of our bodies, as the giver of our souls, as the giver of the one who gives us eternal life. The saints do not sing alone, but they are joined by all the company of heaven. All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen. That is truly, truly, it is so. Salvation belongs to our God. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. For the glory of God is manifested in the salvation of sinners. His wisdom revealed in the foolishness of the cross. His honor and power and might revealed in his conquest of death. Then the angel asks John, Who are these clothed in white robes? And from where have they come? Who are these sinless and righteous ones who are clothed in the Lamb's righteousness? The apostle answers, Sir, you know. I do not get the sense that John doesn't know who these are, but that he is overwhelmed by joyous disbelief. It is the feeling that you get when you see something that is so precious and so joyous that you can hardly believe it. Perhaps you have experienced that sort of joy. It is the joy that a mother experiences after childbirth when she first holds her baby and looks into its face. Who are these clothed in white robes? I imagine John tearing up. It's Peter. It's Paul. it's Thomas. And there is my brother James. Not dead, but alive. Not sinners as I once knew them, but perfect. The angel answers his own question. These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Salvation belongs to the Lamb, and these are his saints, washed clean by his precious blood. The Lamb is the great martyr who has borne witness to the kind of love that the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. Some have been called to bear witness to Christ with their own blood, like the apostles did. These we rightly call martyrs and hold up as examples of faith. But all Christians who are faithful unto death are witnesses. All of them are martyrs. And across the road, we have a garden of martyrs whose testimony is engraved in stone so that we might always remember God's faithfulness to them and their faithfulness. These are the martyrs who have gone through the great tribulation. These are those who have suffered under sin, death, and the devil. These are the Christians who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, who have been baptized and clothed in Christ's righteousness, those who have gone before us in faith. These are the ones who have died to the world but are alive to Christ. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall never die. Those who have gone before us sleep in their body, awaiting the resurrection. But even now they are standing before the throne of God and singing, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. The Lord promises they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. This Lord's Day, every Lord's Day, especially when we celebrate the Holy Communion, it is my prayer that the veil is ripped from your eyes and that you see the vision that John saw by faith. The saints gathered with the angels and archangels with all the company of heaven around the throne of God. Have you ever wondered why we gather around the altar in a half circle? It is because all the company of heaven are here. Peter, Paul, and Thomas, John, Walter, Marlon, Gretchen, Mary, Lola, and Kevin, all of the saints are standing with us, robed in white, cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. When the bread and wine now become body and blood are presented and the words spoken, the peace of the Lord be with you always, we share in John's vision. We behold the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world enthroned on the altar, enthroned on the mercy seat. With angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we sing and laud and magnify the holy name of God, saying, holy, 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 heaven and earth are full of thy glory. No saint ever dies. As the Apostle Paul says, when a Christian leaves this world, they go to be with Christ, which is far better. Every time we partake of the Holy Eucharist, we commune with Christ, and we commune with all the saints who are with him. The King of heaven and earth enters into our midst in his crucified and risen body to rule over us in grace. Thus we sing like the people did on Palm Sunday. And we sing like the saints do in heaven. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who cometh in the name of the Lord. And thus it is that our Lord bids us to do it often. Whenever ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The desire of our hearts should be for the body of Christ and for his cleansing blood, to see him high and lifted up, enthroned here at Zion upon the altar, to be in communion with him and the saints on the Lord's day. You, in expectant waiting for the resurrection, proclaim with the saints in heaven, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And this is not enough for our loving God. He redeems us both soul and body. As we heard last week, the Apostle John says, we are God's children now. We know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. On the last day, your bodies and the bodies of all the saints will be raised up and glorified. Now we see Christ in faith. Then we will see him face to face with our own two eyes. Now, I invite you all to take your bulletin inserts. Look at verse 12 of our reading from Revelation. And join me and the angels in the acclamation. Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. The ushers may receive the offering.